Rockin' Larry Lockin here. Hey everybody, what's going on out there? Hey, I wanted to talk about a couple things today that have been on my mind. First of all, that song right there, "Come As You Are" by Nirvana, the great Kurt Cobain. People talk about where they were. Like you may hear your parents or grandparents talk about where they were, say when JFK was assassinated. I know that both my parents were in class, junior high, I do believe. I think my dad was in high school by that time, but they were both sent home and they remember right where they were. Some people remember hearing it on the TV. Well, I remember the day Kurt Cobain passed away. I had just graduated from high school, like earlier that week, I do believe, but I was still living with my dad. I was 18 years old. My parents were both, my mom or my dad and step mom were both at work that day. Okay, just a quiet, sunny afternoon. They always had this Bose radio out in the den, kind of by the living room where, it played music and then you'd always get the top of the hour news. Well, I was getting out of the shower, getting ready to go to work, drying off, all that jazz, and all of a sudden I hear over the radio, ABC News, rock star Kurt Cobain, lead singer of Nirvana, was found dead in his Seattle home today. And I remember just stopping and it just, my towel dropped and I was just like, wow, whoa. And I remember getting to work that night and some of the girls that I worked with that went to school with were crying and upset and whatnot. But yeah, that's just kind of one of them things that you always remember and you'll never forget where you were when that happened, because he was such a big influence on my generation, growing up in the late 80s and early 90s, whether it was, him and the grunge sound, whether it was gangster rap at the time, alternative, all the different kinds of music that was coming into fruition. It was a really wonderful time. But anyway, back to what I wanted to talk about. I kind of wanted to talk a little bit about dealing with fellow starseeds on Facebook that may be a little bit, oh, I don't know, a little bit one-sided in their views and whatnot. And you get into conversation with some of these people about something, and it never stops. They just keep going and going and going, and it becomes to the point where it's not very productive. I had a situation the other night, and I won't mention the girl's name. She put a comment on my timeline saying that she could no longer follow me because of my view on a post that I had made like a week before. I mean, only two people liked this post. It had nothing to do with the Starseed community or anything like that. I didn't post it in any other groups. I do have a life outside of the Pleiadians and, the Starseed thing that we do. Anyway, the post was of Michael Vick. He had thrown a touchdown pass the other day for the Pittsburgh Steelers. He's their backup quarterback, but playing right now because their main quarterback is injured. So he threw a nice long touchdown pass, and I just said to him, basically, I said, "Congratulations, man. Forget all the haters, and you served your time, and we forgive you." So she went on to proceed to chew into me for that post that I had made, talking about what an animal rights advocate she was, and of course I had to remind her that there's no bigger animal rights activist, or certainly not more than me on earth. So, I mean, I don't say that out of ego, but that's how much I love animals. I'm just a real, I've got a dog and three cats, and every time I see a dog, I, walk by the house or I'm out walking, I'd be sure to stop and pet it and make a connection with it, and I feel the connection in their eyes. But anyway, this lady went on and on and on and on about how Michael Vick, hasn't paid his dues and Michael Vick hasn't shown any remorse. Of course, then I reminded her how Michael Vick, well, he has paid millions and millions and millions of dollars in fines and paying restitution after he served his 2 years in prison, which was about 8 or 9 years ago now. He went to prison for running a dog fighting ring. He was a member of the Atlanta Falcons from when he came into the league in 2001 till 2007 when this all occurred. Anyway, he went to prison for a couple of years because he had let some individuals, friends of his, run a dog fighting ring on his property. Okay, and so they busted the dog fighting ring eventually, and of course his homeboys rolled over on him and all made deals and Michael Vick was sentenced to 2 years in prison. So, okay, he does his 2 years in prison. He gets out in 2009. He's trying to get back into game shape. He makes it onto the Philadelphia Eagles. The following year after that, he becomes a starter again. And so, anyway, I don't need to go through his whole career since, but basically, he's been a quarterback here and there, and everywhere he's gone. When he left the Philadelphia Eagles, of course, there were so many protests when he came to Philadelphia, and that was still early on after his release, and they grew to love him there for a couple years, even after all the PETA protests and whatnot. So he goes to New York, same thing, gets the same treatment, and keep in mind this is 5 years later by the time he hits New York. And that was last year. Well, this year he gets signed late in the off season by the Pittsburgh Steelers to be their backup. Same thing in Pittsburgh. He's got protesters waiting, throwing shit at him, yelling at him, saying how disgusting, what a disgrace he was, and keeping in mind the man had served his time. And this guy is somebody who's toed the line the entire time that he's been out of prison, okay? He has paid back all the money he owes. He's paid back restitution. He could have taken the easy way out and paid less money by filing some bankruptcies, but he didn't. He paid off all his debts. He's been a spokesperson for animal rights. He's done volunteer work. I mean, on and on and on. But bottom line is, even if he hadn't done all that shit, which he has, it really, you know what? He served his time. He did his time. He's toed the line. We can't sit here and keep insulting people and attacking people for what they did in the past. I mean, that's we can't do anything more. I mean, until he does something that crosses that line again, I mean, it doesn't do us any good to sit and harp on him and do sit and judge, because we are nobody to judge. Nobody out in the Starseed community or in the world is anybody to judge. So anyway, this conversation went on and on and on and on and on and on. I tried to get her to understand that I agree with her. And by the way, she had showed me a couple pictures. She obviously is a good-souled, passionate person about what she's into, because she, rescues cats and rescues animals like that. But she's an animal rights activist. And what you find, whether it's with animal rights activists, anti-abortion activists, gun activists, any kind of activist, that's really hardcore into that, it seems like they get just trapped into their cause, right? They're for their cause and nothing else or anything around it matters. Okay, no other issues matter. And if those other issues conflict or intersect with their issue that they're dealing with, well, then that's just too bad. Forget it. There's no leeway. It's just like, when Mothers Against Drunk Driving started in the early 80s, all these people that joined, right, that were mothers that were outraged because they had lost a child. I mean, wearing their heart on a sleeve, completely just wanting these rash laws put into place that would basically are money makers for the system is all they are, that create a thousand other laws with a thousand other loopholes. So anyway, this lady had made some good points, and I liked some of her posts or liked some of her comments. And then finally, I wrote a comment to her and I said, look, I went through all the comments, and I've noticed that even the couple of the comments where I agreed with you on, you didn't like them, whereas I liked yours. And I said, without any ego involved, that really tells me right there, your mindset. You have a one-track mindset. You're worried about your issue only. You're hammering on me and can't be my friend anymore because of me congratulating a football player in the rigged NFL for throwing a goddamn touchdown pass, okay? And telling him that we forgive him. And the strange thing about it was just the other night that she did this, but it was like a week before that I had posted that, okay? I had like two likes on it. No comments. Of course, she said she tried to comment on it, but it got deleted. That's not the case, because I would have had to delete it. It's my timeline. And I post so many things and people put other things on there that it was way, way, it was way down the line a little bit. And so what I come to find out, what I think happened is she was combing through my timeline, okay, liked a bunch of my stuff, but then she found this that I congratulated Michael Vick and went on to say about how if may after a while, after me trying to reason with her, she's like, well, maybe if he showed some remorse, I would forgive him, or he she could be forgiven. And I said, well, Remorse by whose standards? I mean, I guess we'll have to agree to disagree because I think the guy's shown remorse. And that's just my opinion, and that's a lot of people's opinion, is that he has shown remorse and he's paid his debt and whatnot. I mean, what are they going to do? Create a remorse-o-meter? I was telling Sif, they ought to create a remorse-o-meter. Like when you go into the store, you're at the pharmacy or wherever, and you can put a quarter in this machine and put your finger in it, and it'll test your pulse and your heart rate. I mean, what are they going to do? Have a remorse-o-meter like that? It's just really ridiculous. And then my thing was, well, would you be so upset with him if he was somebody that worked at McDonald's, or he was somebody that was a janitor, and yet he had done the same volunteer work Michael Vick has done for the Humane Society and whatnot afterward? Or is it the fact that you're upset, that he's making money playing football, which really he's not making all that money compared to what he's done? I mean, he's paid millions and millions and millions out, and he's only getting the minimum as a backup quarterback, which is still a lot comparatively, but you don't play very long when you're playing a sport like that. I mean, you're lucky to play till you're 40, and that's only, when I say 40, that's a long time. That's only because athletes are in such great shape today, and the workout regimens are a lot more advanced, and so is the equipment they use. But it gets to a point with people where you should always be able to agree to disagree and let it go at that and still remain friends. I mean, if it's so terrible, if it's such a terrible thing that that person said or believes or thought, then it should just go right to you blocking that person and not have anything to do with that person. There's no reason to ever argue or let emotion get in the way at all, period. They totally, activists like that totally wear their heart on a sleeve and have their head in the clouds. It's just really, they're so counterproductive. It's just frustrating because they're so counterproductive to their own cause, yet you can see that they really do care and have a lot of passion, but only for their cause. And they think everything else, every other issue, if it comes up, should have to yield to their cause. And it's ridiculous to deal with that in the mainstream, much less somebody in our starseed community, okay? I mean, that wears their heart on a sleeve, that thinks that, oh my God, and it was totally obvious the girl was wearing her heart on her sleeve through the whole dialogue, up until the point where she thought, okay, well, if he showed some remorse, I might forgive him. Yeah, remorse by her standards. Okay, and then another telltale sign, like I said, was out of all the comments, I liked a few of hers. She wouldn't even like any of mine. And not that I was keeping track for any ego purposes, but I know all and see all. So it really tells the tale when somebody won't, do that and at least give in a little bit of the way, And of course, my twin flame, Sif Gunnar's daughter, was commenting a little bit too in there, and trying to reason with this lady, but there was no reasoning with her. There was no reasoning, and so it comes back. She was acting out of emotion, wearing her heart on her sleeve, probably jealous because Michael Vick plays in the NFL, even though she claimed she wasn't. But I mean, it's quite apparent. If we were talking about Joe Smith, that worked down the street at a hot dog stand, we wouldn't be it wouldn't have been that much emotion stirred up in her. So eventually, I just, after Sif had told me privately a million times, okay, you're not getting anywhere with her. You just need to end it or block her or do something. And so finally I did block this girl because it was going nowhere. And I realized I was dealing with one of those people that have their head completely in the clouds. And all they think about is love and light and all that. But they don't think about these other issues that we have to solve. In the meantime, if we, these issues that we need to meet head on, or we're never going to get where we need to be. Yet the ironic thing about it is, right? Yet the ironic thing is she's dealing with one issue that really is very near and dear to my heart as much as any issue, and that's the protection of animals that can't speak for themselves, our loving friends and guides that are there for us to protect us and provide comfort to us, right? She's so concerned about that, but unfortunately, she's not concerned about anything else, human beings, any other issue out there, what's going on in the world, things of this nature. And I've seen that before. in all kinds of causes, and all it does is give that cause a bad name, because these are great, you know, most of these are great causes in my opinion, and that's just my opinion, you know, abortion rights, gun rights, women's rights, women's equality rights, you know. And speaking of that, you know, I would have been one of the first men on the front lines to die for women's rights in the 60s when they had the marches. More so than anybody I even know. I feel comfortable saying that more so than any female I've ever ran across, I would be there first before them doing that. You know, same thing with the animal cause, you know, same thing with abortion rights. You know, and even people that are against abortion on that side, you know, you have them in there too. People get so hung up on the issue that nothing else matters. Their issue is the only issue that's important. And they'll use the excuse, yeah, and the mantra, well, you know, if I brought that up, well, yeah, you know, somebody's got to, and we're fighting for this cause. Well, you're fighting for this cause, but you're not considering all these other factors too while you're fighting with this cause or fighting for this cause. You're just, you know, you're just hung up in that. And what you end up having is, and you had this too during during the late 60s, during a lot of the hippie movement and a lot of the flower children protests and whatnot, you had a lot of people that were just in more, it became more and more to where it was, that was really the norm in that movement, where most of the people were just caught up in the idea of being in a protest or fighting for something or being rebellious, right? They're more, they get to the point where they're more hung up on a cause, the idea of a cause, than they are the cause, right? They're more hung up on the idea of that particular cause. Excuse me, let me get this right. They're more hung up on the idea of a cause than what that cause actually is. And so it's just so counterproductive and sad to see. And I had to come on and talk about it a little because, you know, it's just frustrating to see, especially in the starseed community. And then I get to the point where I'm thinking, and I told Sif, it wouldn't have mattered what the hell I was talking about. I don't care if I was talking about the most, you know, in favor of the most egregious thing you could ever think of, and I'm sitting there talking about it and, you know, praising it and whatnot. For people to come on and give their opinions is fine and talk about it and be respectful, but to keep going on and on and on and just want to argue and not agree to disagree, it just, it's really ridiculous. And, you know, keep that in mind out there, star babies, when you're talking to other people out there, and maybe you don't quite see it the way they do 100%. You know, give your thoughts, give your opinion, give love from afar, but don't get hung up on debating them over it. I mean, if need be, if it's absolutely necessary and it's a really, really vital, vital, vital issue, okay, you know, you can throw out a couple opinions here and there, debate for a small amount of time in that thread, but then let it go and leave it alone. But you need to stop it. Once the personal attacks come in, it's over with right then and there. You need to cut it off completely. And once you find yourself in that emotional mode where you want to throw a personal attack out there, or maybe do one in response to theirs, okay, at that point, it's time to just walk away. It really is. It's time to just walk away. And if that person continues badgering you, either block them. If you're not an admin in that particular group, report it to the admin. If you are an admin, get rid of them. It's as simple as that. See you, bye. You know, we don't have time to fuck around anymore. This is too important. And, you know, what really makes me sad about people like that, too, is that, I mean, it's one thing. We're already dealing with shitheads like the cabal and the Illuminati and these controllers that are, you know, that we're trying to thin the, you know, we're trying to expose as the veil thins, right? We've got that to deal with, and we've got all those assholes to deal with, right? And then to boot, you've got people that are supposed to be loving, you know, incarnate human beings, and yet they're so hung up on one little facet, one little catchphrase, one little thing that they, you know, they want to go on and on and on about it forever. And, you know, it was really ridiculous of me actually to let it go on that long and keep the dialogue going with her. But, you know, I guess just the passion in me, I thought if I could say one more thing, right, that it would get her to kind of agree to disagree and we could move on from it. But every time Every time I would say something in response, she'd respond right back on my timeline on that, which I've since deleted the post, but she'd respond back with something to counter that. But basically it was saying the same thing over and over again, right? She just was good at putting a new spin on it. So I thought, okay, well, maybe if I say this, I can get her to change her mind. But it didn't. I mean, bottom line, quit wearing your fucking hearts on a sleeve. Okay, there's a time for action and there's a time for letting it be. A time for action is something that comes completely out of consciousness when you do it. It's not something that you're hung up in the idea of doing or you're fighting for this cause, boy, we're really going to. And that's really what, honestly, that's kind of what destroyed the hippie movement in the late 60s or well, in the early 70s, is because so many people were just caught up in the idea of it, right? In the fad of it, the fashion of it. Well, as that fashion started to wane and they realized there was no organization to what they were doing, or there was no more frills to it, they went back to mainstream life and, had some lovely, nice memories of what they did. And really, they did do a lot of good things. They were pioneers for our cause. But I mean, you got to live it day to day. You've got to interact with other facets. You've got to integrate that particular passion you're focused on. You've got to integrate that with other passions. You've got to let that coincide with the passions of people that are close to you and around you, people that you do with, like for us, our extended star family in the groups. You've got to try to integrate that with that and bring a piece of the puzzle to solve this thing, okay? We're never going to get through this unless we do. We're all part of this together, and we're either part of the problem or we're part of the solution, okay? If you're part of the solution, you're bringing things to the table, whether it's even just listening or being there for moral support, giving your opinions, giving your ideas, right? Without, slamming somebody else or without trying to pick a fight with somebody else or emotionally wearing your heart on a sleeve, give me a goddamn break. It makes me so sick. People that do that, it pisses me off more than the cabal or the Illuminati. It really does. People like that, because people like that, it's just like you get so mad in talking to them, and it's like, okay, if I could just flip on that one little switch to connect it in their brain, just one little switch, they'd get it, but they don't. And you know what you're getting with dirt bags like the Illuminati, the cabal, shits like that. You know what you're getting. But with these people, it just pisses me off more so, because they're just, oh. I mean, they're the type of people that, if a brick landed on their head, they wouldn't even get it. So, I mean, just keep that in mind, bring something to the table, be cordial, be nice, be good, and, give your opinion. Channel your passion in the right way. Channel your passion into positive things. Positive aspects of what you're trying to convey. Don't slam anybody else. There's no reason to slam anybody else. If somebody else really is a shithead or their cause is shitty, well, I mean, that'll be apparent anyway. You know what I mean? That'll be apparent to people who really know. So you don't really have to get upset and get all, well, God, if this isn't exposed, this won't happen. And certainly don't go back and start talking about shit that happened a million years ago, millennia ago. I mean, I just couldn't believe it with this Michael Vick thing. I mean, she had to go back on my timeline and obviously find that. And I mean, it's old news. I mean, people need to get on with it. There's nothing that's going to be accomplished to help animals, right? At this point, not one iota by protesting at a game he's at after all these years, by slamming somebody who forgives him, by continue to harp on him after all he's done, for the Humane Society. To continue to harp on him about how it's not enough. I mean, that's not doing animals any good. All, if anything, that's doing is taking your attention away from your own animals and taking your attention away from, other animals that really do need help and support. I mean, this isn't, we're not talking about protesting outside of a company or something that's geoengineering and putting poisons in dog food or using animals for experiments. I'm not talking about that kind of stuff. That's worthwhile protesting, okay? It's very needed. But I mean, to hammer on somebody who did something 8 years ago, who got caught up in something with his friends and all that crap. Well, you know what? It's done with now. He's toed the line for 8 years. Or, 7 years now. There's not really much that's going to be accomplished by protesting at some football headquarters when a team signs him, or he comes in to play a game in your city. I mean, it's so old and unoriginal. In fact, if anything, it really makes the animal rights movement look completely stupid. It's lame. It's beyond lame. It'd be like going back. You know what it would be like? What it's like? It'd be like everybody dressing up in tie-dyed clothes and hippie clothes, right? Which would be cool for just that. But getting some signs and going to the Pentagon, or going outside any National Guard armory in the country and protesting the Vietnam War, with signs that said, "Hell no, we won't go," and impeach LBJ and all that. I mean, that's what it would be like. That's the same kind of effort and mentality that would go into protesting at a football stadium where this guy plays football. It's beyond ridiculous. And these kind of people, with their counterproductivity, are more damaging to our cause than the Illuminati, the Cabal, the Rothschilds, Rockefellers, the people above them, any world leader you could think of. I mean, it doesn't matter. These people are more dangerous to our cause because of their ignorance and their tunnel vision, right, than anybody else. So, I just want to remind everybody, and I'm going to close with that and let everybody, just think about the fact that if you get into an argument with somebody on Facebook, make it brief, and take care of the issue. If they start insulting you, report it to an admin, and block them. Do what you feel, but get rid of the situation and be done with it, because it's just counterproductive to have. And we're supposed to try to be above that. Yes, we're all human too, us starseed incarnates, us Pleiadian incarnates, and Sirian and Arcturian and whatnot. But let it go. Just let it go and walk away. Be stern. You can say a few words back, but fuck, let it go. Especially when it's some lame issue. Not that animal rights is a lame issue. It's a very important issue. But the issue that she was using that to attack was a lame issue. So anyway, I want to thank everybody out there. You can see me, or not see me, you can hear me on Wednesday afternoon at 3 p.m. Pacific time on the Pleiadian Blu-ray Ascension Network show. Bridget Rao and Natalie Alea, I'm going to be their guest on there, talking about Atlantis, and I'm going to give my take on what I think Atlantis was, as well as Lemuria. Atlantis to me was a supercontinent that was destroyed along with Lemuria in a nuclear war that we had eons ago, that's still in our Akash. But I also have several other thoughts of what Atlantis was as far as parallel realities go, because I believe there's been several existences of what we think of Atlantis here on Earth, as well as on other planets and in parallel realities and whatnot. So that should be interesting. I want to give a shout out and a thanks to both of them, Natalie Alley and Bridget Rao. Shout out to Leah Shapiro, Admiral of the Mothership Group Pleiadians. Shout out to Victoria Pleiadian and Lionel Anderson, two great groups there, Alternative Pleiadians and New World Order Freedom Fighters. Also as well, my twin flame, Sif Gunner's daughter and her page, Rainbow Angel 444. And like to give a shout out to everybody in the groups, Fringe Thinkers, of course the Pleiadians, Pleiadians Plus with an Attitude, Pleiadian Light Grid page, Pleiadian Express Productions and whatnot. So I'll leave everybody with that, and I want to just wish everybody a great rest of their week and much love, Star Babies. This is yours truly, Rockin' Larry Lockin', with a big dating game kiss. Mwah.